Today we're starting with the organs of the immune system. So these are the references from which I have made up the study material. And now let's move on. So when we are talking about the lymphoid organs can be basically divided into the primary lymphoid organ or the central lymphoid organs and the secondary lymphoid organs. And then we have a tertiary or there's a peripheral lymphoid organs. So these are the very simplified basic divisions of the different categories of lymphoid organs. Among the primary lymphoid organs, the two basic category of lymphoid organs that is observed in humans is thymus and bone marrow. Now bone marrow in mammals, but the name and births of Fabricius in birds that was extensively studied. When we are talking about the secondary lymphoid organs, we will be dealing with spleen and lymph nodes. And finally, when you're talking about the central and the peripheral or the tertiary lymphoid organs, we'll be talking about the various mucosal associated lymphoid tissue. So this is the broad classification of the different category of lymphoid organs. When we use primary lymphoid organs, or use the term primary lymphoid organs, they are basically the sites where lymphocytes develop and mature. The T cell precursor comes from the bone marrow, but fully developed in thymus. So even though the T cells come from the bone marrow, they fully develop into the thymus. That is the one category of the primary lymphoid organs. The second category of the primary lymphoid organs is the bone marrow. In humans and mice, the bone marrow gives rise to the B cells as well as the T cells, but the maturation of the T cell, the bone marrow gives rise to the T cell precursors, but the maturation of the T cells occurs in thymus. The maturation, the rise of the B cells and the maturation of the B cells is totally restricted to the bone marrow. In birds, B cells develop in bursa Fabricius. When we are talking about the secondary or the peripheral lymphoid organs, these are the sites where the lymphocytes encounter antigen, become activated, and undergo clonal expansion and differentiation into effector cells. So it is in the peripheral lymphoid organs that the different immune cells, specifically the cells of the adaptive immunity, if you remember the T lymphocytes and the B lymphocytes, it is in these sites, the spleen and the lymph nodes, that the lymphocytes encounter the antigen, and once only when they encounter the antigen, they are thereby activated. So they include, as you can see, the spleen and the lymph node. This is an extension of the third category that has been shown here is an extension of the secondary lymphoid organs. This include basically the mucosal associated lymphoid tissue. And these tissues are often compartmentalized into T cell areas and B cell areas. So we'll be getting into details one by one. So this is a very schematic picture, as you can see. So this is the fetal liver. Initially, it is in the fetal liver that the hematopoietic stem cells develop. And then the hematopoietic stem cells move to the bone marrow. The T cells, the precursor T cells move to the thymus for maturation. So we have the B lymphocytes and the T lymphocytes. It is in the secondary lymphoid organs when they move that they are exposed to antigens and they become the effector and the memory cell population. So we have effector T and B lymphocytes once they get antigenic exposure, and we have the memory T and B lymphocytes. Now, coming to the structural organization of the tissue organization, the lymphoid tissue organization, you can see that these are diffuse lymphocytes. This is a picture which I had shown you earlier. Here you can see the lymphocytes are present in form of follicles. The follicles are collected into patches. The follicles are collected into patches, and the patches are collected into organs. So this is the organization of the lymphocytes. This is the organization of the lymphatic system. So once mature lymphocytes have been generated, as we see through the first in the T cells, it is thymus. In case of B cells, it's bone marrow. And then they move into the secondary lymphoid organs for further maturation and antigenic exposure. These lymphocytes then circulate in the blood and the lymphatic system. So the lymphatic system is a network of vessels that collect fluid that have escaped into tissues from capillaries of the circulatory system. This is a schematic representation of the various primary and the secondary lymphoid organs as present in our body. So you can see the major primary lymphoid organ, bone marrow. The other major primary lymphoid organ, the thymus. And when we are coming to the secondary lymphoid tissue, the main two organized secondary lymphoid tissue are the lymph node and the thymus. Why is the spleen? Just a second. So we have the spleen, the major two organized secondary lymphoid organs, and then the remaining is the mucosal associated lymphoid tissue. So the lymphoid tissue that is associated with the mucus lining of our body. So we have certain lymphoid tissue associated at the mucosal lining around our respiratory tracts areas. We have this belt present in the lower respiratory mucosal and the bronchial patches. We have gut-associated lymphoid tissue, intestinal mucosa, Peyer's patch, appendix, urogenital mucosa. We have skin-associated lymphoid tissue. So these are the various categories of mucosal-associated lymphoid tissue. It can be the bronchus-associated lymphoid tissue, the nasal-associated lymphoid tissue, the skin-associated lymphoid tissue, and the gut-associated lymphoid. So when we are moving down this lane of understanding the lymphoid organs, we'll start with our primary lymphoid organs. We'll know about the bone marrow, the thymus, and then we'll move on to the secondary lymphoid organs. This is another picture of the various. You can see the primary lymphoid organs are marked in blue, and we have the lymph nodes and the spleen as the secondary lymphoid organs. And the mucosal associated lymphoid tissues, you can see they are present all over the body, all the mucosal lining of the body. Now, if we look at the functional organization of the lymphoid tissue, so it is the bone marrow, the main structure where the B lymphocytes and the T lymphocytes develop, but the precursor stem cells of the T lymphocytes move into the thymus where they mature. Once the development and maturation has occurred, the B and the T lymphocytes then can move into the secondary lymphoid organs. So the secondary lymphoid organs are again of two categories. So now this bone marrow and the the lymphocytes from the bone marrow and the thymus, once they mature, they move into the secondary lymphoid organs. The secondary lymphoid organs are again of two basic categories. You can see encapsulated, so it's organized structures, the lymph node and the spleen. And we have this unencapsulated lymphoid tissue, which is the mucosal associated lymphoid tissue. Now, one important difference to be noted here. Lymph node, so the immune response. In the lymph node, all the antigens, the immune response is to the antigens that are present in tissues. So whenever a lymphocyte is moving into lymph node, it is being exposed to the antigens that has been captured from tissues, okay? But whenever the lymphocytes are moving into the spleen, they are being exposed to the antigens present in the blood. So this is one very distinguishing functional aspect of lymph node and spleen. So when we think about the immune response they are generating or the antigens they are displaying in the lymph nodes, it is the antigens in tissues, and in case of spleen, the immune response is to the antigens in blood. And when we are talking about mucosal associated lymphoid tissue, the immune response that is generated here is to the antigens in the mucosal surfaces. So remember this three functional difference between the different categories of the secondary lymphoid organs. When it's lymph node, it is immune response to antigen in tissue, spleen, immune response to antigen in blood, and MALT, immune response to antigen in at mucosa. So once we are thorough about the basic functional differences of the primary lymphoid organ, the secondary lymphoid organ, and within the secondary lymphoid organ, the functional differences between the lymph node and the spleen and the MALT, let us move on to the first category of the lymphoid tissue, the primary lymphoid organs. So the primary lymphoid organs, now the main function is the immature lymphocytes are generated in hematopoietic. Immature lymphocytes are generated in, and they become committed to a particular antigenic specificity within the primary lymphoid organs. The important point to be noted here is that only after a lymphocyte has matured within a primary lymphoid organ does it become immunocompetent, capable of mounting an immune response. So that all these immature lymphocytes, they mature in this primary lymphoid organs for B lymphocytes, development and maturation in bone marrow, for T lymphocytes, development in bone marrow, maturation in thymus. And once they mature, they have this, develop this capacity to mount an immune response. As I said, T cells mature in thymus, B cells originate and mature in bone marrow. So let us move into the thymus. If we look into the thymus, you can see this is, just give me 1 second. This is a thymic lobule that has been shown here. If you remember the initial structure I showed you, the lymphoid organs are of two categories, capsulated and encapsulated. So thymus is has a capsule. So you are seeing the capsule present. And within the capsule, so each lobe is surrounded by a capsule and it is divided into lobules, which are separated by these structures, which are known as trabeculi. So these extensions that you can see in here are singular trabecula, plural trabeculi. So they are separated by trabeculi. Now each lobule, so now we are restricting ourselves to a single lobule. Each lobule has a cortical region. Check out the cortex region. So this part is the cortex region. And then we have a medulla. So one, each lobe is surrounded by a capsule. Second, each and is divided into lobules. The lobules are separated by trabecula. Each lobule is organized into a cortical region and a medullary region. If we look into the cortex is densely packed with immature T cells called thymocytes. So look at the green color cells. They are of bone marrow origin. So the cortical region of the thymus is densely packed with this green colored thymocytes. Whereas the inner compartment, if you look into the medulla region, you are seeing that the medulla is sparsely populated with these thymocytes. We're not getting presence of much thymocytes here. And apart from this, there's another thing to be noted is that both the cortex and the medulla of the thymus are crisscrossed with three-dimensional stromal cell network. So we are having three-dimensional stromal cell networks. We are seeing some cellular network occurring within this cortical region. So this three-dimensional stromal cell network that has been formed here, what are the cells that compose it? So the stromal cell network is composed of the cortical epithelial cells, you can see, the dendritic cells, and the macrophages. So these three cells form the major stromal cell networks of the thymus. If I look into the immunological function of the thymus, as you can see, they produce and select huge variety of T cells that will protect our body from infection. It is within this thymus that the T cells undergo both positive and negative selection. This is regarding positive and negative selection is regarding whether T cells are reactive to foreign antigen or T cells are reactive to self antigen. So there is a selection. The T cells are schooled. If some of the T cells are more reactive to self antigen, then they are forced to die. If some of the T cells do not react with foreign antigen also, they are forced to die. So there is a schooling done. So this schooling is done in thymus. Now, this is the gross structure. Apart from this, many of the stromal cells interact physically with the developing thymocytes. So this is another picture of the thymus. So you can see the trabecula, we can see the presence of the cortical epithelial cells, we can see the presence of thymocytes. Now we have the presence of another category of cells present here, which is the nurse cell. So some of the thymic epithelial cells in the cortical region have long membranous extensions. You can see a nurse cell. They're having this long membranous extensions that surround as many as 50 thymocytes, forming large multicellular complexes. They help in development of the thymocytes. The name itself suggests that they are helping in the development of the thymocytes. So this is about the thymus. Another important function of the thymus, one function as I said, is that in the thymus, the T cells undergo both positive and negative selection. Another important thing that happens in the thymus is the maturation of a double negative T cell into a single positive T cell. Now, if you remember, while talking about the T lymphocytes, I had said that T helper is categorized by the presence of the CD4 receptor, while the T cytotoxic is categorized by the presence of the CD8 receptor. So when we are talking about double negative, this precursor T cell do not have either CD4 receptor or CD8 receptor. It does not have either of the two receptors that are the defining receptor of a T lymphocyte. As it moves down through the cortical region, it initially becomes double positive. That is, transiently, the maturing lymphocyte develops both the CD4 receptor and the CD8 receptor. And then there is this final maturation into the single positive cells. So when we have this transiently expressing T lymphocytes, having both the CD4 and the CD8 receptors, then there comes an antigenic exposure and some of the double positive cell becomes single positive CD4 receptor and some of the double positive cells, T cells become single positive cells having the CD8 receptor. So the double positive cells become CD4 plus T helper cell or they become the single positive CD8 plus T cytotoxic cell and they come out of the medulla and they gradually move. So this is another category of schooling that takes place within the thymus. Now, this is the location of the thymus. As you can see, the thymus is shown here. This is the heart. This is the thyroid. So it's just beneath the thyroid, above the heart. And if you look into the thymus, you can see that the thymus gradually decreases in size and cellularity after puberty. So with age, it gradually disintegrates. So that this is one correlation that we can draw, is that with age, our immune system gradually fails. So our thymus gradually decreases in size, cellularity, functional capacity with age. So now when we are talking about thymus, we move on to the second primary lymphoid organ, that is bone marrow, which is the site of hematopoiesis. It is the site of origin of the B and the T lymphocytes, even though the T lymphocytes mature in the thymus, we just now saw, but it is the site of origin for both B and T lymphocytes. In adult humans, it is present in ribs, vertebra, sternum, pelvic bones. The immunological role is very vital. As I said, it is a site of B and T cell origin. This is a site of B cell development. And there are stromal cells. These are cells which provide nourishment to the developing B lymphocytes or the T lymphocytes that interact with the B cells and produce cytokines for the development. Now, the name B lymphocytes, we had discussed the cells of the immune system and we had talked about lymphocytes. The name B of the B lymphocytes came from the fact that it was first discovered in bursa of Fabricius, which is a lymphoid organ associated with gut in birds. So you can see this is the bursa of Fabricius. Many often pronounce it as bursa of Fabricius, but I pronounce it as bursa of Fabricius. It is the primary site of B cell maturation in birds. So the B lymphocytes get their name from this bursa of Fabricius. The T lymphocytes, the T comes from thymus, because even though the T lymphocytes originate in the bone marrow, since their major schooling is taking place in the thymus, so the T of the T cells, that name comes from thymus. The B of the B lymphocyte comes from the name bursa of Fabricius. Now, these are the long bones, and it is within the marrow of these bones that we find the bone marrow. So you can see this is the bone, and this is the marrow in the medullary cavity that has been shown here. And if we look into the next pic, you can see, so bone, this is the marrow region. These are the endothelial cells, cytokines, and growth factors. And we have macrophages, perivascular cells, and these are the hematopoietic stem cells. This will give rise to our lymphoid precursor cells, which will again give rise to the B lymphocytes. Now, B lymphocytes, bone marrow is not the only site for B cell development. In humans, it is bone marrow. In mammals, most mammals have bone marrow acting as the site of development of B lymphocytes. For example, in birds, the lymphoid organ, as I just now said, is bursa of Fabricius, which is the primary site of B cell maturation. In mammals, such as primates and rodents, there is no bursa and no single counterpart. So there's no bursa, it's bone marrow. In cattle and sheep, the primary lymphoid tissue hosting the maturation, proliferation, and diversity of B cell is the fetal spleen in early gestation. Later, this is assumed by a patch of tissue embedded in the wall of the intestine called the ileal Peyer's patch. In fact, we also have a Peyer's patch present on the lining of our gut. In case of cattle and sheep, bone marrow, as you can see, is not the site of development. Fetal spleen is the initial site of development. And then the patch of tissue in the intestine plays an important role in further development of the B cells. In rabbits also, the gut-associated tissue, such as the appendix, is the primary lymphoid tissue for the proliferation and diversification of B lymphocytes. So this is about the bone marrow, because I'm not getting the detailed structure of the bone marrow because it is basically more of an osteological differentiation. we have the hematopoietic cell. I showed you the structure of the hematopoietic cells, stem cells developing here. Next, we move to another important part that I discussed in one of my earlier slides, was the presence of the lymphatic system. Now, why is this system important? Because once mature lymphocytes have been generated in the primary lymphoid organs, they circulate in blood and lymphatic system. So it forms a network that moves throughout the body. For example, just to give you an example, these are the primary lymphoid organs of our body, the one we discussed just now, the bone marrow and the thymus, right? So we are having the B and the T lymphocytes. These are the lymphocytes. And so this is, they can move into the lymph node. They can move into the mucosal associated tissue. They can move in and out of the spleen. They can move in and out of the peripheral tissue. So this is connected. The whole thing is connected. So the lymphocytes can move via the lymphatics into tissue spaces. From the tissue space, the lymphocytes can move into the lymphatic circulation. This is, the left picture is another example. You see, there is a, this is an example. See, a small antigen has been exposed here on the wall of the small intestine. I said that the intestine is lined by mucosa, and mucosal linings have immune tissues, lymphoid tissues. I just discussed at the initial stage. So these antigen is picked up by immune cells in the mucosal tissue. So you see the antigen is being picked up. See how the antigen is moving. The lymphocyte is moving. It is coming to the mesenteric lymph node. The lymphocyte is moving into the blood. And you can see it is passing through the blood. If required, it can again come out from the blood. If not, it is moving. Again, see if required, it can again come out in the salivary and the lacrimal glands. If not, it is circulating. So you can see, this is how the blood vascular system and the lymphatic system are connected intricately so that the lymphocytes so can move around the body. If an antigen has been exposed in one part of the body, that is small intestine, after some time, the information that there is an antigen moves to a cell that can, it's present in a genitourinary tract. So the message can move. As the cells are mobile, as the cells are having this defined lymphatic system, the cells are capable of moving from one part of the body to another part of the body, carrying the information that they have been exposed to an antigen. This is another example. This is the skin mucosal barrier. So the antigen might directly enter the blood. The antigen might enter a tissue space. The antigen might enter the immune tissues present in the mucosal lining. See the route of entry of antigen. It can directly enter the blood. It can enter through skin, which are blood is not a physical barrier, but skin is a physical barrier. So it can directly enter into blood, blood-borne antigens. It can directly enter into the tissue space, that is the skin, or it can enter the mucosal lining, the tonsils, the Peyer's patch. And through circulation, you can see it is now, the antigen is now moving into spleen. So if you remember, when I was talking about the immune response that is generated by a particular lymphoid tissue, so I talked about that, the spleen actually generates immune response to antigens present in the blood. So this is how, so from the blood moves to the spleen, and in the spleen, the immune response is generated to antigens in the blood, antibodies are produced, and they move via different lymphatics, and T cells and antibodies move into circulation. If an antigen is exposed through tissue space, so this, through skin, they move into the afferent lymphatics, lymph node, efferent lymphatics, T cells, and antibodies into circulation. And finally, if it is through a mucosal lining, see it moves into the efferent lymphatics, and via this through the thoracic duct into the heart and then into circulation. Just keep in mind, when we are having an antigenic exposure at the level of the skin or the mucosal lining, the entry of this antigen into the blood is a bit delayed. Because once the benefit of having the antigen entered into the blood is that the antigen will move into the spleen. Spleen is a, when we'll be studying spleen, we'll be seeing the spleen is a storehouse. The spleen efficiently manages and functions as a beautiful secondary lymphoid organ, toning up, I mean, bringing down the antigenic load of the body. So if there is an antigenic exposure to blood, the immune pickup is a bit faster as compared to if the antigenic exposure is taking place at the skin level or at the mucosal lining level. So this is about the lymphatics. And I'll stop my class today here. Tomorrow, in the next class, we'll start with our secondary lymphoid organ.